Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the 5th annual DoD Pride Month event. I am Major Jennifer Carbajal, a member of the DoD Pride Employee Resource Group. DoD Pride is comprised of lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender civilians, military members, contractors, and allies of the LGBT community. I am greatly honored and proud to be able to serve and support this country, along with my fellow military members and civilians across the nation and the globe. It is the department's policy to ensure all Americans are treated with dignity and respect. Today, we would like to take time to reflect and celebrate the victories that have affirmed freedom and fairness across the Department of Defense. This event is an opportunity for the entire DoD community to come together and celebrate the great diversity of the American people in a festive, affirming atmosphere. It is my privilege to welcome you and ask that you please stand for the singing of the national anthem.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hail at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
Please be seated. Please join me in a round of applause for Sergeant First Class Randall White of the Volunteers of the U.S. Army Field Band for that wonderful rendition of the national anthem. Ladies and gentlemen, it is now my privilege to welcome the 75th Secretary of the Navy, the Honorable Ray Mabus.
Thank you, Major. To my fellow service secretaries, Secretary Fanning, Secretary Murphy, to distinguished guests, most importantly, to the sailors, Marines, soldiers, airmen, Coast Guards, and DoD civilians, those here representing and those supporting the LGBT community, today's a good day. Although it took way too long for policy to match reality, and while there's still work to be done, we've made a lot of progress toward achieving DoD Pride's goal of ensuring that all members of the Department of Defense are empowered to support its mission in an inclusive workplace free of discrimination. Now, a statement like that just shouldn't be controversial, shouldn't be a problem. But just 5 years ago, an event like this would not have been possible. There were those in uniform on the Hill and in the American public who favored continuation of Don't Ask, Don't Tell. That policy required LGBT service members to lie, to hide, in order to serve. It's a policy that was insidious and morally wrong. Throughout this debate, though, those opposing the repeal of Don't Ask, Don't Tell used exactly the same flawed logic as those who had earlier opposed racial integration or gender integration, claiming that policies of inclusion would erode the warfighting capabilities of the United States. That's a suggestion that's not only an insult to the professionalism of our armed forces, but it undermines our core values as servicemen and women and as Americans. It's because of individuals like the people here today, the members of DOD Pride, who fought for dignity and equality, and because of institutional leaders who will be honored here today, like Admiral Mike Mullen, who had the courage to do what's right. On September 20th, we'll celebrate the fifth anniversary of the repeal of Don't Ask, Don't Tell. A lot's happened in those 5 years. In the immediate aftermath, service members who had lived parts of their lives in the shadows and often in fear were able to be fully open about who they are. They were able to be with and now to marry the people they love, able to see senior leaders speak honestly about their experiences. The numbers are big. 65,000 active duty LGBT members, 1 million LGBT veterans. But it's the individual stories that bring home what this means. Not long after the repeal, I was in Manaus, Kyrgyzstan, the base that people came through on their way into or out of Afghanistan. And after an all-hands call, a Navy corpsman came up to me and said, "I just want to tell you how relieved I am. So I'm gay, and I just finished my third combat deployment. And the thing I was worried about the most was not being able to serve." Now, how bad is that? Somebody who has done 3 combat deployments on behalf of this country, and his biggest fear was he would not be allowed to continue to serve because of who he loved. More recently, in this last 5 years, we've adjusted equal opportunity policies to include gay and lesbian members. The Supreme Court decided states cannot ban same-sex marriage. And just a few weeks ago, my good friend and colleague, Eric Fanning, was confirmed as Secretary of the Army. And I got to do this, and I apologize, it's not in my notes, but Eric, we're going to show that we're at absolutely equal opportunity at the Army-Navy game. 15 years in a row this year. Sorry, I had to. In our department, the Department of the Navy, we've reached out to people discharged under Don't Ask, Don't Tell. And we're working with organizations like DOD Pride and others that advocate for the LGBT community. We've met with a lot of those organizations and other VSOs to reach out and tell people, if you were discharged under Don't Ask, Don't Tell, come in. The Board of Corrections for Naval Records will take a look at changing that discharge characterization. And I would ask you all to do the same thing. If you have colleagues that were discharged under that, ask them to come in. Get the, if it's under the regulations, get that discharge characterization changed. All of this is the basic idea. If you can meet the job standard, you should be able to do the job. Whether it's opening submarine service and riverines to women, whether it's opening all positions, including SEALs and Marine ground combat to women, time and again, history has shown this is the right thing to do. When we face racial integration, when we integrated women into the service, when we repealed Don't Ask, Don't Tell, every time those changes were proposed, every time, there were naysayers saying the force would be weakened and unit morale would decrease. And yet, the Navy, the Marines, the Army, the Air Force, the Coast Guard are the most powerful forces in the world today. And it shows that a more diverse force is a stronger force. When we talk about diversity, the main thing we're talking about is diversity of background, diversity of thought. We have to continue to recruit, train, and develop a force from all of America's talent. We need a force representative of and reflective of the nation it defends. And because of that, we're a more effective fighting force. If a person qualifies in every way for service, how can we possibly say, that they cannot share in the honor of defending this country because of who they love or the shape or the color of their skin? We cannot. We should not. And now we do not. I'm happy to be here with you today. By your willingness to serve and serve as who you are, you epitomize the Navy motto, Semper Fortis, always courageous. The Marine motto, Semper Fidelis, always faithful. Thank y'all.
Thank you, Secretary Mabus. In line with this year's theme of celebration, we will now honor two individuals who have made a significant impact on the lives of DoD service members and civilians, specifically through their commitment to diversity and advocacy for equality. Here to present the DoD Pride Employee Resource Group Civilian Leadership Award is Navy Lieutenant Blake Dreeman. Lieutenant Dreeman, would you please come forward?
The first DoD Pride Employee Resource Group Civilian Leadership Award recipient is the Honorable Patrick J. Murphy, Undersecretary of the Army. Undersecretary Murphy has served his country with distinction, leading his fellow soldiers in Iraq, representing Pennsylvania's 8th Congressional District, and now positioning the Army during a time of rapid change. His courageous leadership in the U.S. House of Representatives ensured that President Obama was able to repeal Don't Ask, Don't Tell, which made our military stronger through increased unit cohesion and diversity. In Congress, he also co-authored initiatives including the 21st Century GI Bill and Hire Our Heroes legislation. He has spent his career advocating for equality, a stronger military, and a commitment to our veterans. We are pleased to present the DoD Employee Resource Group Civilian Leadership Award to Undersecretary of the Army and Chief Management Officer, Patrick J. Murphy.
I'm a reformed politician, so I have to say a couple words real quick. First, hey, Lieutenant, thank you so much, and thanks for your service. I was a lieutenant 20 years ago, so you look a lot better than I did in that uniform, so thank you very much. To all of you, first, let me just say it's great to have my boss here, Secretary Eric Fanning. Sir, we are thrilled not just of your leadership, but how you're leading from the front since you've been back. So thank you so much for all that you do. To know that your biggest advocate in the Senate was John McCain, I think, and who was your champion on your qualifications alone is a testament of your leadership and what you're gonna do for the Army. And we're just so proud to have you back leading our team. So thank you for being here. Secretary Mabus, it's great to have you here, except for that last part that you ad-libbed. You need to listen to your staff. Listen to your undersecretary, probably told you it was not appropriate because 14 years is enough. Because the Fanning-Murphy team is undefeated in Army-Navy game, for the record. In fact, we're going to Baltimore this year, usually it's in Philly, where the Army was founded, the Navy's founded, and the Marine Corps was founded. But and the Air Force is like your little brother because they were part of us. But We'll see this year. We'll see this year. But I think Secretary Fanning has some things up his sleeve. To Alex and Rudy, thank you so much for your leadership in making DOD Pride make this event really become a reality, and for all your leadership in today. I was here for the first event 5 years ago, and to be here and see how it's grown and see all of you being here is pretty special. The one thing I would say, beside thank you, and I'm going to sit down very quickly, is that we have a lot to be proud of where we are and where we've come. For me to write, you know, the bill that repealed the National Hotel is something that I will take to my grave and something that I'm proud of. But the fight for true equality, which is the fundamental value of our U.S. Constitution that we take an oath to support and defend, all of us take that oath, civilian and military, that fight for equality ongoes every single day. And you only had to look at what happened across the river when they tried to override the president's veto on saying defense contractors don't have to live up to the values that we fight and some of us die for. So that fight for true equality in LGBT community will continue as we move forward. And I want to say thank you for all of you for standing with us side by side in that fight, and you will always be a battle buddy of mine. So God bless all of you. Thank you so much for this great award. Major, thank you.
Thank you, Undersecretary. Here to present the DOD Pride Employee Resource Group Military Leadership Award is Mr. Merrick Garb. Mr. Garb, would you please come forward?
The first DOD Pride Employee Resource Group Military Leadership Award recipient is Admiral Michael Mullen. Admiral Mullen served as the principal military advisor to the President, the Secretary of Defense, the National Security Council, and the Homeland Security Council as chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff from 2011 to 2011. In 2010, Admiral Mullen testified before Congress stating that he unequivocally supported ending the Don't Ask, Don't Tell policy. Upon his retirement, President Obama thanked Admiral Mullen for his service to this country, stating, quote, "Our military draws its strength from more members of our American family. Patriotic service members who are gay and lesbian no longer have to lie about who they are to serve the country that they love. History will record that the tipping point towards this progress came when the 17th Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff went before Congress and told the nation that this was the right thing to do. Mike, your legacy will endure in a military that is stronger, but also in a nation that is more just," end quote. Admiral Mullen's courage and willingness to speak truth to power makes him a worthy recipient. We are pleased to present the DOD Pride Employee Resource Group Military Leadership Award to Admiral Mike Mullen.
Accepting on behalf of Admiral Mullen is Mr. Bert Jellott. Mr. Jellott, would you like to say a few words?
Thank you. Good morning. I am Bert Jellott, retired Air Force Master Sergeant and former NCOIC of Protocol to the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff under the leadership of Admiral Michael Mullen. I am honored to accept this award on his behalf and humbled by his faith in me. He has told me that he gratefully accepts this award on behalf of all who have faithfully served. On February 2nd, 2010, I was standing at the copy machine in the protocol office when on the television over my head, Secretary Gates and Admiral Mullen were speaking in front of the Senate Armed Forces Committee. I had no idea at the time what they were talking about until I heard those now famous words spoken by Admiral Mullen. "It is my personal belief that allowing gays and lesbians to serve openly would be the right thing to do." I stood there in shock. I was overwhelmed with emotion. Never did I believe that I would ever hear something like that in my career, not even in my lifetime. This coming from the highest ranking person in our military, from someone who I truly respected and admired. I was tired of lying, tired of worrying if I would be outed, wrenched in fear during routine security investigations, worrying that the next telephone call from the commander was to eject me from the military for being gay. On the day of the repeal, Secretary Panetta and Admiral Mullen held a press conference in the Pentagon press room. I was there to witness that historical moment with a handful of other non-press individuals. Later that afternoon, in a room full of staff and security, he asked me why I had been in the briefing. Was I there to escort the group? He then asked me for the third time, but why were you there? I then confessed to him and to everyone around, I'm gay too. His first reaction, as I recall, was confusion, then realization, which brought a huge smile to his face as I then began to thank him for all that he had done for us. It was with Admiral Mullen's courage and leadership and his personal belief in us that I was able to serve my 24th and final year in the United States Air Force with honesty and integrity. Thank you.
Please join me in another round of applause for our distinguished award winners. As you all know, no celebration is complete without a cake. It is now my privilege to welcome the Honorable Ray Mabus, Secretary of the Navy, and Airman First Class Zachary Chrisman, a junior member of DoD Pride, to join me on stage to continue our celebration by cutting the first slice of cake.
Celebration.
support that made this year's celebration possible. DoD Pride would like to thank the volunteers of the U.S. Army Field Band for their support and great music. Thank you. DoD Pride is also tremendously grateful for the cake and cupcakes provided by the families of the American Military Partners Association for today's event. Thank you. And thank you for attending today's ceremony, and above all, for supporting the DoD community in their service to the nation and for helping honor our award recipients who stand for equality. Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes our event. Please join us for some cake and cupcakes and enjoy the music. Thank you for attending.
Into a weapon or a drug. You could be the outcast or be the best.